Okay, hello everyone. How many weeks do we have until sports break?
Four.
Two.
Three.
To sports break.
Oh, three.
There's four to sports break?
Three.
Mine too little.
Three.
Oh, four.
And
yeah, sorry.
Oh, three.
Okay.
Three. Four includes. That's what I.
Three.
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 It's four until
exams.
Yeah,
that's
three.
That's
how
it's
28
until the 5th of March.
One,
great.
Two, three.
Okay, we're running out of time, is what I'm getting at. So we got a lot to cover, and not a lot of time to cover it. So I hope you are attending lessons, paying attention, because we're trying to squeeze as much in as we can before mocks, and there will be even more afterward. So we've got another concept today for you. I've been waiting with this one because I wanted you to have a few plays under your belts so that you can apply your knowledge of the plays to it. So we're going to be talking about roles and the persons who occupy plays. If you're wondering why, I think the most important reason for approaching this and understanding this, taking notes and studying this idea, is that the majority of paper twos, I think, are written about characters and roles in plays, comparing them not only within a play, but with other characters outside of one play to another as well. So it's a common thing to write about, which is why I'd encourage you to take this one in. So I'm going to start with a little story. Ibsen wrote a play, he's Norwegian, in the late 1800s called The Doll's House. Has anybody read that one? Two. Okay, good. That's none. There's an antagonist in the play called Krogstad. And there was a reviewer sitting at the premiere, and as soon as he walked out on stage, the reviewer was upset by the presentation of his character. He said, quote, "His makeup bore evidence of the mark of Cain," meaning he had dark skin tone. Though at the time, it was sort of tradition that you would understand who a character was as soon as they walked onto stage, right? Then you'd know. Hero. Bad guy. Helper. House elf, these sorts of things, right? You get it as soon as they make an appearance. But this reviewer didn't like the way in which Ibsen presented this character. He felt that it wasn't developed. He felt it was like cheating in a way, almost. So his complaints regarded conception. Do you know what it means to conceive of something? You nod. What does it mean to conceive of something?
To think of something, to give birth to something.
Yeah, to give birth to something, right? So all dramatic roles are conceived. That's going to be our first topic today. How a playwright conceives of that character and the inception of that character for an audience. That's important. We've talked a little bit before about how we rely on things like stereotypes and our own experiences in order to understand a character. This plays into that sort of notion. So I'm going to throw a few technical terms at you right now. These are good technical terms that you can use on your exams and might impress an examiner. You never know. So conception is based on these two things. You can see it sort of as a surface level and a deeper understanding of who that character is. So the first thing I want to tell you about is a role's mode. Call it a mode. You'll know this as a character being on a spectrum of being simple to complex, right? The basis of a character, the underlying idea, is what it stands for or what it represents in a play. Yeah, so you've got surface level and you've got what lies beneath. So if we talk a little bit about mode, audiences tend to look at the psychology of a character to help them understand first. Or they're presented with that most obviously, right? You get the psychology of a character through dialogue, monologue, soliloquies. You get it from their actions and reactions to other characters. So I think a really good example of two characters that have different modes would be Sam and Willy from Master Harold and Boyce, right? They share certain things, but they are two unique and different characters. Would you say that one is simple and one is complex? I think that you would. Which is which?
Willy is simple and Sam's complex.
How does Fugard help you to understand that Willy is simple?
Having him follow more basic stereotypes.
he's more stereotypical, okay? While Sam is
contradicting all the stereotypes.
How does Fugard contradict stereotypes? Help him out. Yeah.
Maybe because Sam actually brings up facts of school and things like historical, like.
Right, Sam engages with Hallie on an intellectual level, right? They have their whole discussion of men of magnitude, and the brunt of the conflict within the play is between Sam and Hallie, right? So Sam is the complex character, Willie is the simple character. He needs to exist for several reasons, but you can see a differentiation between the two of them based on a sort of psychological approach, yeah? Another thing could be like language. Willie uses Afrikaans words. Sam is able to traverse over and speak the academic way that Howie does too. Yeah.
I guess Willie also has the juggling queen, and Sam has more of a juggling queen,
a waiter. Willie, sorry, I didn't hear you.
Willie cleans and Sam greets him like the waiter.
Right, and you almost feel like he's tricked into it. Yeah. So that's a really simple thing, right? We see the idea of cleaning as being menial labor for people who aren't educated. For that sort of person. So that's another way that that's reinforced. Very good. After psychology, you can start to approach characters from an ethical sort of viewpoint. I know we didn't read Antigone, even though she shows up at the end of Oedipus Rex, which we did read, but it's also a play by Sophocles. It takes place after the events of Oedipus Rex. And in the play, Antigone's brother is killed, and she wants to bury him on the grounds of their country, while Creon, who is also a character in Oedipus Rex, you might remember him, says, no, we can't do it. It's against the law, it will upset the gods, it will hurt the reputation of our city-state, so you can't do it. And it's this sort of ethical dilemma between the two characters of what's the way to make a decision. Is tradition the way to go? Is honor the way to go? Or is the needs of the state? Or the religious background, what should determine the right thing to do. So that sort of ethical complexity, that comes after the initial psychological idea. Something important to note when it comes to understanding the mode of a character is that a character can be psychologically complex, but that doesn't necessarily make them simple. If you think of Act 5, Scene 1 of Hamlet, where he has the interaction with the gravedigger, you could see that character as being psychologically intelligent due to the interplay of puns and words between the two of them and the jokes about whose grave is it? Do you remember this one? Whose grave is this? It's mine because I'm digging it. No, who is the grave for? A woman, but alas, she's dead. That whole interaction. He's a complex character who presents complex ideas and introduces us to sort of the ambiguity of the whole situation. But at the same time, he's not as integral as a character like Hamlet, like Ophelia, like Claudius. Yeah? Okay, so that's a character's mode, understanding the difference between being simple and being complex. Right? Here are a few examples, hopefully you guys will know. No, I'm sorry, this is on to the next thing. Now we're on the basis, right? I showed you earlier in the slide, there was the mode on top and the basis below. Basis is the underlying concept of the characters. I think Fugard's Master Harold and the Boys is a really good example. We can see race as being the basis for understanding the characters. Hallie is white, and Sam and Willie are black. Have you guys finished Glass Menagerie yet with
no.
Dave? Okay. Do you know who Tom is?
Yes.
You do know who Tom is, okay. He can be, his basis could be social class. Right? What social class does Tom occupy? What? Working, lower, working, yeah. I couldn't think of a good one that you guys might know for representing a fundamental drive, so I took Scrooge McDuck. Do you all know Scrooge McDuck? He is the exemplification of greed. Everything that he does, every decision he makes, everything that he says is based on the want of monetary gain. And we talked a little bit about Antigone and Creon, in that they are representative of tradition, honor, religion, and reputation. Do you get the difference between the two? Mode is a spectrum of being simple and complex. while the basis of a character is the underlying sort of aspect of that character. That's how you can come to fully understand both a character's representation for a play, but also their function within the play. Got a few notes? All right, I'll take it. These are just a few examples of these sort of basis for characters. There are a plethora of them. If you can think of it, it will work. Yeah, Sarah?
If we were to talk about the mode and basis in a paper, in an example,
on paper
say two. Mode, would the person know what mode is, like what we're talking about?
They should
about?
Do, yeah. I think, yes. Yes. I've given you a few more, right? One of the things that I want you to understand is that little equation that I made for understanding a character. It's not one thing and one thing, yeah? There are all sorts of things that a character can be based on. Usually, we can identify one as being sort of dominant, with others supporting, but there are lots of different kinds. Sam and Willie versus Hallie is a cultural aspect of the character. A discursive aspect would be like a perspective like Marxism. That character is Marxism, or that character is pessimism, and that character is optimism, that sort of thing. A character can have a formal basis. That character is the narrator, right? Formal being a direct function within the literature. It can be stock types, like Joachim von Enka, who is a capitalist pig, right? Have you met Laura yet in the Glass Menagerie? She's a really good example of a pathetic character. She's kind of pathetic. What does she do? Like in life. She has a glass menagerie. That's it, right? Eventually other people come and things get broken and it's really sad, but she's pathetic. That's the basis for her character. Universal, right? That character is representative of women, men, that sort of thing. So don't limit yourself to the ones that I'm giving you. You have to think about the individual characters and the plays that we're reading and understand the multiple bases from which they come. And I think having a firm grasp on that will make the comparative aspect of paper two easier for you. It's a good way to study, is to map out what the modes and what the bases are for all of the characters, or if you're trying to save time, the major characters in the plays. Does everybody sort of understand where I'm coming from this? Cool. Any questions? Good, then I'm gonna have you prove it to me, okay? What I want you to do now is look at how Shakespeare, Stoppard, and Williams conceive each of these three characters. So, just cut it off here. Sarah and you guys in the back over here, I'm gonna give you all Hamlet, okay? Front row, I'm gonna give you guys Guildenstern. You, five in the back, I'm gonna give you Amanda. Hopefully you've been reading. Okay, four of you hopefully have been reading. One person was honest and said no. We'll see how far we can get with that. Give it a try. Okay, I want you to figure out the dominant mode and basis, and I want you to figure out supportive modes and basis, and then I'm going to have each group present their findings to the class. Any questions? Yes.
I feel like with Guildenstern, we watched about 5 minutes to fill, like, I don't even know.
How much we watched 40 minutes. Okay, I'll come back to you in 15 minutes. I want at least the dominant modes and bases for the characters.
I'm going to try to figure out what she's
Dominant is the condition that if he gives the condition that if he can get lost, he can go wherever.
So he represents the, like, the ignorant.
Thank you.
I was thinking of
Gertrude.
What?
Sorry.